So thank you very much for joining, and in this very personal, I think, quest for functional programming in Emacs. So I'm not a computer scientist, and if you are a computer scientist and you think I'm getting it wrong, then please feel free to get back to me. This is very much a personal perspective, but Lisp was the second programming language I learned, the first one having been some sort of tiny computer basic or some such. I have been programming Lisp for a while, and Emacs as well. I am actually, so my natural home, if you like, is Common Lisp rather than Emacs Lisp. Okay, so let's see what we can do today. This is sort of a general overview of the talks. The previous talks, as David mentioned, are still available. They've been recorded somewhere. You can see the slides. This talk is what I sort of call advanced topics, though you might disagree, I think, or we'll see. And there will be more stuff to come later. And it is very much a personal perspective on using Lisp for functional programming. So to summarize the first three talks in a single slide, this is sort of the superpower tools that I thought I would want to try to identify that are available in Lisp for functional programming and make things really nice. For example, mapping functions actually implement many of the common paradigms that you would normally use recursion for, but obviously they don't recurse because they just map across lists. And that makes it much easier to write in Lisp because you don't get in Emacs, you don't run out of stack or anything, even if you process large lists. So the list of what I sort of call quote unquote advanced topics are, this list is basically here, and I was planning to do the first four today. And it'll be a little bit sort of a mixed bag of things, I think, because some of these topics are quite long and have a little bit of theory and stuff in them. Some of them are much shorter, and we'll just have a bit of, oh, look, we've talked about this, and then we can move on to something else. So five and six are slightly longer topics, and seven I haven't finished writing yet. So we can't do those yet, but we'll see. So let's start looking at functions and languages and stuff, because we know functions take arguments, and arguments, you can have zero arguments, you can have one argument or two arguments. So for a moment, let's think of plus as a binary function. It takes precisely two arguments, and those arguments are obviously numbers. So I'm trying to get rid of this zoomy thing on my screen. So imagine that plus is a binary function, and then we give it one parameter, one argument, give it the other one. So if I just say plus two in a normal functional language, then it will bind two to one to the first argument to plus, and the other one is still unbound. So what I get is a function of one variable, namely a function which adds two to something. If I want to say that in Lisp, I have to say lambda x plus x2, because that is then the most concise way I can express a function that adds two to some number. So I can express that as a function of a single variable. So in functional programming, you will often find the notation of a function. It will say plus, and it will say one colon or two colons. Notation varies a bit from one author to the other. And then it will say int, arrow, int, arrow, int. And the idea behind that is that plus itself is a function which, if you give it one integer, then it returns a function that takes an integer and returns an integer, like the one that adds two to something. If you give it two integers, then you just get an int back. So the notation is there to say that you can sort of fill up the arguments to the functions one at a time by binding them one at a time. In functional languages, you normally bind them with the first argument first, and then the second argument, and then the third argument until you've run out, until the function has all its arguments, and then it can evaluate. In And in Lisp, of course, you could just bind anything you like, really, because with the plus, I have actually, when I say plus x2, I have effectively bound a second argument to plus, if plus were binary. And it doesn't matter because it's just a lambda expression the way I want. So if you go and read or try to read functional papers and stuff, then you will often find this plus arrow notation. That, and we will probably, I think, make use of it later when we get to monads or some such. So the notion of currying, which is named after Haskell Curry, is effectively saying that we can bind some of the arguments of a function, and then we get an argument of the ones that are yet unbound, which is itself a function, until we have bound them all, and then it can evaluate, and then we get a result of some description. So in this talk, I had also not planned to talk very much about lambda calculus at all, but I will just mention, because we're talking about lambdas in Lisp, so there is a connection, obviously, to lambda calculus. For example, there's an expression here on the slide where lambda x dot xx means that it's an anonymous function that has one parameter x. And if you give it a parameter x, it returns x juxtaposed with x. So xx effectively means call x on itself, because just putting things together in this notation means call the thing to the right. So the first lambda x of xx is called on the second lambda x. So what it does is to take this second value and bind it to the x in the first expression. And then it calls it on itself, and you sort of get this expression out of it. And if we actually try this in Emacs Lisp, we almost get the same thing. Because if I just say lambda x list xx and lambda x list xx, then, and call that on itself, then I get the corresponding closures. If I evaluate a lambda in Emacs, I get a closure. Now, list xx is not necessarily the same as funcall xx, but this was just to illustrate the expansion of the lambda list. In that we actually do get something like it. If I just type list xx, then the second lambda is bound to the x in the first lambda, and then it creates the list of these. So you can see that's pretty much the same thing. If I then evaluate it again, then what is expressed as a list in this expression, rather than a function call, will become a function call. Because, as you know, the outermost list in Lisp expresses a function call. So hopefully that's clear. That's why I've got list here rather than a function call, because the list, when I evaluate that, is a function call. It will take its first element and call that on its second element as the argument. Okay, so this is sort of more like a curiosity, really, but just to say that there is a connection of some sort between the lambdas and lambda calculus. In practice, lambda expresses an anonymous function, as you know, which, when I evaluate it, becomes a closure in Emacs. If I try to coerce the lambda expression into a function, then the same thing will happen, because it will just say, yeah, it's a closure. So technically, the lambda isn't really a function, but in almost every context you can think of, it will behave as if it were a function, because it gets coerced to a function if it's found in the first item in a list, like where the function should be. So the other thing, I won't go into this too much, but I just thought it's worth mentioning that in common Lisp, functions can return multiple values. So in Emacs Lisp, functions always return precisely one value. And in functional programming, that is normally what you see. Functions return precisely one value. But in common Lisp, functions can actually return any number of values from 0 to an implementation-specific maximum, which is usually quite high. The thing is that while functions can return multiple values, normally it is only ever the first one that gets used. If you want to use all of the values returned by the function, you have to use a special construction like this multiple value bind. So in common Lisp, for example, floor returns the quotient and the remainder of integer division. In Emacs Lisp, it doesn't, it will just return the quotient. But then in a normal context, in common Lisp, if you wanted to use the floor function, you will just get the first value and it'll, the second value will be ignored. If you wanted to capture the second value because you have a some large integers perhaps and the calculation is slightly expensive and you might as well calculate the quotient and the remainder at the same time because you're doing Euclid's algorithm or something, then you would need to use multiple value bind to capture those. And there's like a handful of multiple value constructions that can access the subsequent values returned by a function. But even in common Lisp, if I say plus floor 12.7 and then 3, floor 12.7 will give me 1 and the remainder value 5 will get ignored because if I wanted to use it, I would need to use one of these multiple value constructions. The other thing to note, if you just think two slides back, when we talked about lambda calculus, the lambda x and then x dot x, the first of those had a value substituted into it. So in fact, lambda creates a binding just like let does. If I have a lambda expression here, that is now the first part of the list, so it gets evaluated, then that v will be bound to the whatever I pass in as the argument to the function, which in this case is 6. And inside the function, in the body of the function, there's an expression plus v and then another let that binds v again. So there are now the same symbol v represents a variable in both cases, but it has different bindings. The innermost binding is created by let and will bind v to 2, and 3 times 2 is 6. The outermost binding is set by the function call in the lambda expression, and the binding here is v is bound to 6, so you get 6 plus 6, which is 12. I know there's a dangling sentence here at the end. I'm not sure what I was trying to say. I was trying to remember, but I can't remember. So moving on, list comprehension is another one of the things that people talk about for functional programming. Because you express the kind of list you want to build and what you want to build it out of, and then your language happily starts constructing that list for you. Now, I would argue that loop is list comprehension in Lisp. And you're probably thinking that loop for I from 1 to 10 collecting the square of I is a very imperative way of writing things. It's like a for loop. But if you really wanted to, IOTA, so you loop for I in IOTA 10 or whatever, and you could use that. If you use the more advanced constructions like loop for A list, and then you concatenate the lists that create that you get by collecting A and B comes together, then you can see it actually picks one from the first list and picks ones from the other list and puts them together and eventually get all the pairs, which is precisely what you want in list comprehension. The other thing you might want to do if you have a function that has side effects and you want to call it several times because you want to see what those side effects are or what happens if you're generating random numbers or something, then, whoops, sorry, wrong button. Then the easier way is to say loop repeat 10 times, collect whatever those random numbers are, rather than creating a vector of length 10 and then mapping stuff into it or something, which looks a little bit artificial. If you're a purist, you may want to say, well, I really want to use functional languages. I don't want to write for, but in my opinion, just using loop for these kind of things is actually quite like list comprehension. And list comprehension is apparently considered quite functional, so it's not too bad. The one other thing I wanted to, as I'm now plucking off the random topics at the top of my list, is to look at mutually recursive functions. So we looked at recursive functions in the first talk, because recursion was the elegant engine of doing stuff and dividing problems into smaller problems and building a solution out of that. And we've seen that several times. What you can also have is mutually recursive functions. And I don't want to go into details, but I have an example with the source code that I will also put in GitHub. And if you're like me and you get a puzzle and you think, actually, it will be more fun to write a program that solves this puzzle than to solve the puzzle myself, then you will probably have done this before. So as an example of a puzzle, you're given an numerical array of length 2n, and you want to place the digits 1 to n into it so that every digit k has k digits between the two occurrences of the digit k, if that makes sense. So between the 5, if there is a 5, you have 5 digits between the two 5s. You have 4 digits between the two 4s. You have 1 digit between the two 1s. And every digit occurs twice. So you want to have a function or something that solves that problem for you, given initial constraints, the size of the problem, perhaps. And so here's a short example. If n is 3, then you want to have, maybe you're just given the 1s, and you want to try and find all the solutions, or at least one solution. And it will put, you can see this is a solution between the 3s, there's 1, 2, 1. Between the 2s, you have 1 and 3. And between 1s, there's just a digit 2. So that's a solution to this problem.
Is that now, always a solution?
Sorry?
Is that always a solution?
There's not necessarily always a solution.
Okay.
Yeah. It depends on the starting, or there may be more than one solution. It depends on the starting conditions.
Thanks.
So originally, when I designed this solution, I had 3 functions mutually calling each other. I think in the revision, it's just 2 functions mutually calling each other, but the call graph looks like this. So there's a top end solver, and it calls the various subordinate functions. And then there's a recursive engine inside of it that will actually do the solutions. And I don't want to go into this detail here in details here, but I will give you the source code so you can go through it at your leisure and try and find out how it works. The thing to point out, though, is if I use SVCL, which is my normal common Lisp implementation, it will complain if I write a function that has that tries to call something that hasn't yet been defined. And that's because SVCL compiles things as soon as it reads them. Now, it's still okay, as we saw last time in the last talk, it's okay for me to have parts of my function that are not defined. I just get a warning when I load them. But it will still run, provided that the thing that I'm trying to call, that everything I try to call has been defined. Or if I'm capturing an undefined function exception or something. So it's okay for me to have parts of my functions that haven't been defined yet, but I still get the warning when I load them. However, if you do your things in labels, if you remember, labels introduced the locally defined functions that could recurse and call themselves, they can also call each other without any warning, because it sort of creates a little space around the functions that says, I'm now enabling the functions that I define locally to call themselves, but they can also call each other. So if you're really a purist and you want to say, well, these functions call each other and they need each other to be defined together, you may choose to stick them into a labels construction and then just say that, yeah, these are now together and they call each other. So that's just an add-on to the discussion we had last time when we talked about when you should do labels and when you should do standalone functions. It's a little bit of a matter of taste, but if you want to emphasize that functions can call themselves and each other, it may make sense to stick them into labels. I think in this particular problem, I have done both, so you can see what they both look like. Okay, moving on. So I wanted to talk a little bit about how we use functions in practice for some various things. So if you imagine that puzzle I had before with the 1s and 3s and 2s and stuff, now, it may be that there's more than one solution, and I want to find all of them. But inside of this call graph, it might have gone really deep into it, and there will be a stack that I need to keep, and there will be state and lots of things that I need to keep track of, so I don't want to throw that away if I want to find all the solutions. If I just want to find a single solution, it's okay for me to just say, if this is a goal state, by some hypothetical goal p function, then I just throw found and then say what the state is. So this is just my solution. But if I want to keep going and find all solutions, I would probably want to be able to get back to it. So we should see later somewhat more advanced methods for doing that. But one option is to pass a callback into a function that says, whenever you find a solution, then call this callback on that solution and then carry on working. And that callback could print it out, it could save it to a file, it could gather it into a list, it could do sort of whatever is I want it to do. And that is just a useful way for me to get things to accumulate while eventually the function will unwind itself as it goes back up the stack here and say, I have now found all the solutions because it's a finite search space. So that's just a way of saying you can use functions, because we can use functions as arguments, I can pass a callback into my big solver function. And every time it finds a solution, it will call that callback and the callback will then do something sensible with it. So let's suppose for a moment we wanted a Fibonacci number. And this is my common Lisp implementation. It takes the nth number starting with zero that I am looking for. And then it takes optional parameters, which are actually passed in as my, initially when I call the function, they're not used at all, but then they get defined because I haven't specified them when I call it. So when I say fib10, for example, then A just gets initialized to zero and B gets initialized to one, and then it will start calling itself and recurse. And this is what it looks like. If I trace it, then you can see that there's, I call the function, first it says just fib because I have traced the function. And then I call it with fib5 and you can see what the call stack looks like. It says five, then it goes to 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, because the first element k just counts the number of numbers that I want, or the nth number. And then you can see the remaining variables get set to 1, 2, 3, 5, and 8. And eventually it just returns 8 and goes back to the top, and I can untrace my function after that. Trace obviously is an extremely useful thing to have when you're debugging functional programs, because it takes whatever comes into the function and it says, here's what came into the function. Then it looks at what comes out and says, here's what came out. And then you can see whether the function actually behaves as you intended. And if it doesn't, then you can try and debug it, obviously. The trouble is that this is common Lisp and Emacs doesn't have trace. So suppose I wrote the same Fibonacci function in Emacs, which looks like this. So Emacs doesn't have default values as we saw last time for the optional parameters. So I use or B1 to say if B has been defined, then use B. And if B has not been defined, then use 1. Obviously, when it starts recursing, then B is defined because I'm passing in the optional parameters. It's just in the very first call that it's not defined. So if I had spent more time on this, and I would probably have put in maybe a main function and a recursive functions inside with labels or something. So it becomes a little bit tidier, but who cares? So this function, as you can see, works exactly the same way. It does exactly the same call, passes exactly the same parameters in. So in the recursion, B gets passed in for the A value, and A plus B gets passed in as the B value, and then it recurses till K hits zero. So in Emacs, we can do something different because Emacs has something called advice for functions. So suppose I write a function, just a helper function called myTrace, which takes a name and a function and its arguments. It prints a formatted string of the name and the arguments. The name is just a symbol, so it just tells me what function is being called, because the function might just be a lambda expression and not have a name. Or it might be a closure, it's more likely it's a closure in this case. So it doesn't have a name. So the closure leaves me none the wiser. So I want to have a tag and name that says what it is that I'm calling here. Then it calls the function using apply, and it saves the value in some variable. It says this is the value. Then it prints out what the value was and finally returns the value. So the effect of using myTrace is that it, if you like, intercepts the function call and says, your function, you're about to call a function with these arguments, then it calls the function, and after the function has been called, it says, this is what the function returned, assuming the function returns something. If the function runs forever, or if the function raises an exception, then this argument will fail, but we can always make it more sophisticated, if you like, and to at least catch exceptions and stuff. Anyway, in Emacs, you can add advice around a function. So what I tell it is the symbol fib names my function, and I want to add an around method, an around advice to the function. And all it does is to carry my trace by binding value fib as my name in the function call, and then it passes in the function and the arguments. So advice is a little bit like intercepting your function call, and you can tell Emacs when you want to intercept it. So if you look at this keyword parameter colon around, which is a keyword, it says I want to intercept the call and essentially not call the function at all. I want to call it myself in my trace function, and I don't want Emacs to call it at all. I could also add before or after. With before, the advice will run before the function is called. With after, the advice is run after the function is called. Or I could add both before and after methods, and then of course before will be called before the function and after the function. So as you can see, I've also given it a name using an A-list, and there are only two values that are accepted, two parameters that are accepted inside the A-list, the name and something else. I can't remember what it's called, but it's said to add the in which order, which priority you want to give it, because there could be other around methods to this fib function that somebody else has put there. So I might want to say whether my around method should run first or next. And I call it an around method. This is not what Emacs calls it. And I call it an around method because CLOS, the Common Lisp Object System, calls it an around method. So I can't help call it an around method, but Emacs calls it an advice. So this is what happens in Emacs. Once I've installed this, then I call fib. And you can see it doesn't quite have the nice formatting, but I could introduce that if I worked a little bit harder. But it gives me exactly the same trace value of the function calls, and it's exactly the same values that I had before. So you can see it says returned 8888888 because it's recursive call. And it just says how often, obviously every time it returns 8, because the recursion is the last part of the call. So I just end up getting this long stack of 8s, and it's just returned and eventually gets passed back as the final value of the function. And then I can call advice remove once I'm tired of tracing it, and it will just take it out again. And here it's using the name that I gave it before. So here it says in my A list name.trace, and so trace is the name that I've given my advice. And when I now say advice remove trace, then it will look for that name in A lists, like we saw in the last talk, and just remove it. And then effectively the function is untraced. So this is sort of a cheap and cheerful way to build traces into Emacs and debug your functions, which I think is pretty neat. Because for a long while I thought that Emacs didn't really have traces at all. Right. Emacs also, as I'm sure you've probably seen if you've done any kind of Emacs programming, it will have lots of hooks for customizations. So there's a variable called text mode hook, for example, which will contain some function or other. And you can add a hook to that. So for example, if you wanted to have autofill mode, you could put it into the text mode hook. And every time the Emacs enters text mode, it will then also run autofill mode. And so you'd get autofill mode every time you run, every time you're in text mode. There's probably better ways of doing that, but it just illustrates how you can use the hook to customize Emacs. And there are lots of hooks for all kinds of things. Emacs, in fact, talks about two kinds of hooks, normal hooks and abnormal hooks. And normal hooks can be either a list of functions that get called with no arguments, or there are also supposedly functions, just a single function, so not a list of functions, but just a single function. Though I can't actually think of any at the moment. All the normal hooks I can think of will have a list of functions to call when their event triggers. So here's another example. If I evaluate C++ mode hook in my Emacs, I get irony mode because for somewhere inside my configuration, something has added irony mode into my C++ mode hook. And if I then add another hook, which is just a lambda function that says a message, hack and be merry, then every time I go into C++ mode, it will switch into irony mode, and it'll give me a nice message that says hack and be merry. The 10 is a priority that it where I want to put it. So can be a negative number or a positive number, and the hook will put it in according to the priority you give it. So you can see the hook is actually returned by at hook. So it will have irony mode there, and it'll have the closure of my message thing. If I gave it minus 10, for example, then the closure would come first, and it will have irony mode next. Okay, so that's it for the hooks. I realize I'm sort of rattling through topics a bit here, but because I wanted to get all the sort of loose ends out of the way before we get into some of the larger topics. And I still think some of the loose ends are useful, like this tracing thing, for example, can be quite useful because you can put that tracing thing into a macro or something clever, and it will then extract the symbol and use that mytrace call to wrap around the actual function call. And it will then trace things for you and dump things out on your screen. So it can actually be quite useful. So this is a nicer alternative to putting debugging statements into your function and reloading them. So we talked a bit about higher order functions when we talked about lambdas. And here's another example. Compose is an example where you have a function f and g, and you want to call g first in this case, and then f. And this is completely straightforward. Lambda takes some data into it, and then it calls g first on the data using apply, because data can be a list of things, because I've captured it with rest. And g then returns a single value, which I then use to pass into a function called f, which must take a single value. And even in common Lisp, if g returned multiple values in the function call, still only the first of those values would be used. So it was even in common Lisp, the compose function will look the same. And you can see how it works. If I type control square root and plus on a list, then the list gets wrapped into the data. The function g is the plus, so it will sum the things together, which becomes a 9, and then we'll take the square root of that. The difference is that the composition is created first, as you can see. So the compose function runs first, and it creates a closure, the lambda, which remembers that it's supposed to call g first and then f. And then that lambda is called on 2, 3, and 4. So the function has been composed before I call the first function. So that's why we work with higher order functions, why we say that. I get a function that takes functions as an argument. It returns another function, which I can then call. So another example, compose square root and absolute value. So that gives me a function expressed as a lambda, a closure, which will take a number, and it will then take the absolute value, then take the square root. And you can see it has done precisely that here, minus 1, minus 4, and it gives me 1 and 2. So the thing to take away from this is that we're actually acting on the functions as arguments and returning functions, which we can then call. So the function compose, if you like, is a function of functions. because it's designed to be applied to a function. Here's another common example. Remove if not is a common Lisp function in Emacs Lisp, or in common Lisp as well, obviously. And so I could say remove if not even p. So remove a number if it's not even, which is actually a nice function to have because, as you can see, it essentially says select if. Give me all the variables out of this list that are even numbers. Now, for some reason, they have tried to deprecate that in the standards committee and saying you don't need remove if you just have remove if. And it would be nicer to just have remove if rather than remove if not. I sort of disagree because I like remove if not as the concept of select if. But you could say remove if complement even p. Even is a predicate. And if I complement it, then obviously I get odd p. But if I wanted to express not even rather than odd, then like if it was something some more sophisticated predicate, then remove if complement predicate should express the same as remove if not. Of course, functionally, it returns exactly the same, but you're also telling the programmer who reads this, which could be yourself, what you're trying to say. So remove if not could be expressing select if, or it could be saying remove every number that is not even or something. Emacs does not have complement, but we can easily write it because it just takes a function which is assumed to be a predicate and inverts the value that comes out of that. So it just takes the arguments, which could be any number of arguments, applies the function to it, and then takes not of that value, assuming that it's a generalized Boolean. And again, what happens here is function is a function and complement is a function of a function, which returns a function that we can then call later as as any normal function that we have elsewhere. Okay, so that's it for higher order functions. Now we're getting to some of the slightly larger topics. And this is actually the last topic that I intended to cover today, but we can move on a bit if it turns out we have more time. So I wanted to spend a bit of time looking at symbols as well, because symbols are quite powerful tools in Lisp that you don't really find the equivalent of those in other languages. You find sort of things like enums in C, or maybe it uses strings in other languages. But as we saw with the months last time, you can actually use symbols as very efficient tags for looking up stuff. In A lists, we could use symbols as keys, and they can actually be used for lots of useful things. So I thought it was probably worth looking a little more closely at what symbols can do, because they can be sort of abstractions like enums. They can be names that can bind variables or functions or various other things, can name types, and they can be keys and generally anywhere you need something that's atomic, something that is not a const or a sequence. You can use a, in principle, you can use a symbol. And we've even seen that with the bindings that you can bind them and then you can shadow the binding, like in the lambda with the let inside it. You had the V that was bound to a value and then it was bound inside of that again. The V is still the same symbol, but depending on the context, we look up a different binding. And we'll, in a later section, we'll look a little more closely at that and how that can be really useful. So let's first look at symbols and see how far we get. Nil is a symbol and it evaluates to itself. And then I ask whether nil is an atom, and it is, because nil is not a const. Nil may be an empty list, but it's not a const. So it is indivisible and it is indeed an atom. If I say EQ, quote Fred and quote Fred with uppercase F, then they're not the same symbol in Emacs because they have different, they're different symbols because they have different, capital letters and stuff. If I say EQ Fred Fred, then I get T because T is true, because they're the same symbol. And if I say EQ make simple Fred, so I create two distinct symbols with the name Fred, but they're not the same symbol. So what's going on? So let's look at what symbols actually do and how they're useful. A symbol has precisely three things in Lisp. It has a name, or more accurately, it has a print name, which is the name that gets printed when the printer tries to print a symbol. And it has a package, and it has a property list. And we'll look at those in turn. The name is, you can extract the name from a symbol by using the function symbol name, and it returns the symbol's name as a string. So the string itself is a representation of the name of the symbol. The symbol itself is not composed of characters in any way. But once you've extracted the symbol name, then you have a string which is composed of characters. So it's important to remember that the symbol is indivisible, it's atomic, it does not decompose into F-R-E-D or anything at all. It is simply a simple Fred that is indivisible and untouchable. Conversely, you can create a symbol that, like Wilma here, and with a particular string, a particular print name, as a particular string as its print name. And when you then extract a symbol name, when you extract the print name from it, you get the string back. It may not be the same string, but it will be an equal string to the one you put in. The package, I'll talk a little bit about packages, but Emacs doesn't really do packages, so I don't want to say a lot about it. And then there's the property list. The property list is an ancient piece of Lisp technology that works a little bit like an A-list in the sense that it has key value pairs, but it works in a slightly different way. There are some important differences between A-lists and P-lists. But plists are important to know because they're used by Emacs a lot. In common Lisp, they're hardly ever used at all. I can't think of a single thing that actually uses them unless you use them in your programs. But in Emacs Lisp, they are used a lot. And here, for example, I've just looked up the plist for the symbol car, which, as you know, names a function. And it will then have loads of stuff inside that explains to Emacs and the programmer, if you like, lots of things about how car works. So let's look at how plists work in general. With a symbol Fred, I can ask, what do you know about the symbol foo? And it says nil because there's nothing in the plist. So the function get takes a symbol and a key and looks up that key in that symbol's plist. So my symbol here is Fred and my key is foo, and I look it up saying, is there a value associated with foo in the plist for Fred? And there's nothing. So it's important to get used to how these things work. If I want to set a value in Fred's plist associated with the symbol foo, then I use the set function to set that place to a particular value. And then I can use get Fred foo afterwards, and it will return precisely that value because it's looked it up in the plist. If I then say get Fred bar, and I set that to 17, so it sets that as well. And when I now say symbol plist Fred, you can see that foo has the value blimps and bar has the value 17. So a plist is essentially, unlike the dotted pairs, unlike that you saw on A-lists, they're essentially key value, key value, key value. So a plist always has even length because you always have a key and a value next to each other. And this is actually, if you remember back to the last talk when I talked about, I had just done some work in plists and I was trying to show you how the automote A-list looks like in Emacs. And I got confused because I was actually trying to look up keys using a plist terminology, but I was actually automote A-list is an A-list, obviously. So it got completely messed up. Plists are used to store properties for a particular symbol. In this case, we just look at the symbol Fred and we say what properties have been associated with that symbol. And those properties could be stored by myself as a programmer, or they could be stored as hints to the compiler, as hints to an optimizer or something. So they're just used by either by the programmer or by Emacs or both. So I may want to check before I set values in there that Emacs is not already using those values. Now, it is plists are less sophisticated than A-lists because you can just do the lookup. If you remember the A-list, it actually returned the const cell, which was really useful for lots of things. So you don't get that with plists. You can still do the shadowing if you like by pushing something onto the plist, but normally you don't actually do that because you would use the self to update the value of a property of a given symbol. So that will not do any shadowing. It will just change that particular value if it's there, and it will create it if it's not there. So Emacs, as I say, uses them extensively. So you can look up values like sort as a function. The particular value that Emacs likes to keep for these functions are stored for the symbol sort. Is it side effect free? It is not. Is map car side effect free? It's not. If you look up car, it will be side effect free. And so you get all of these properties, which is probably of less interest to yourselves as programmers, but they are of interest to Emacs when it tries to compile and optimize code. And also, you'd probably want to use symbols and not strings, because as you can see on the bottom of the page, if I try to set a key, which is a string, then lookup will fail because it will use EQL as the comparison function. So that's not going to work. So all of this is just to say that the plist exists, and ordinarily you will not need to use that as a programmer unless you really wanted to store stuff, properties associated with a symbol. So the advice that I put in before on my fib function actually gets added to the fib symbols plist in some format that makes sense to Emacs. And then when I say advice remove, it gets taken out of the plist again. And you can forget about it. And normally you wouldn't need to look into the plist yourself, but you may want to because you are trying to debug something or you're trying to find out why Emacs treats your symbol as something special. There are also ways to remove, this goes back to it is really ancient Lisp. So there are lots of, I think in older Lisps, there used to be a put function as well. So you would say put symbol key value, and it will then put that into the plist. Now put disappeared from Lisp at some point. So instead we have this serf, that is indicated by get the symbol and a key. Okay. So that's it for the plists. Mostly you don't need to worry about them, but they can be useful to inspect in Emacs because Emacs makes use of them. If we now move on to the packages that I mentioned that I wouldn't talk much about, and I will say a little bit about it. The point is that a symbol is normally in common Lisp is looked up inside of a package. So symbols can be imported into a package, but they will generally always have a home package where they belong. So when a common Lisp starts up, there's normally a common Lisp package where all the predefined symbols are car, sort, CDR, and all those functions, mapcar. There is a user package where I can create my own symbols and by create a new user package. So I could actually create my own car function in my own package, which if I do it right, shadows the one in common Lisp and can call the one in common Lisp if I wanted to, because they will not conflict with each other directly because they will be in different packages. The point is that a symbol is referred to as its name when you are within a particular package. Emacs, as I say, doesn't really have packages, but it does have sort of keywords and things. And essentially, keywords are a package of its own kind. And there are things in Emacs that behave a little bit like packages. So the other point to remember about packages is that most symbols that I create by saying make, if I say, if I type the letters Fred, it will create a symbol called Fred if it doesn't exist already. And if it does exist, it will return the same symbol that I meant before. It will be the same symbol every time. However, when I said make symbol and then pass the string Fred in, it actually creates a symbol that is not in any package at all, even in Emacs. Now, Emacs doesn't have packages, but still the symbol doesn't have any home package at all. So the symbol, when I say make symbol Fred, it creates a symbol with the name Fred, but it's not in a package. So it is not equal to the Fred that I can that I can reference as a symbol. And if I type make symbol Fred twice, they're still different symbols. In other words, when I use make symbol to create a symbol that can't reference, except by a very special syntax that I'll show you in a minute. So I can actually use that. So if this is a piece of code that I've extracted from one of my advent of code or some such, it updates a list using some sort of by counting numbers of pairs that it encounters. And as you can see, I've used gensims to generate temporary symbols that are not referenced by anything else, which is useful in macros, because even if the stuff I want to call is inside of them, it doesn't matter which symbols I used inside of my the things that get passed into my macro, because I'm just using gensims, which are guaranteed not to be used inside any other code. And it doesn't matter so much what this code does. The thing to look out for is the gensim that I've used here. I can actually use the same thing with make symbols. And I can use make symbols, I can get the reader to make symbols for me, using a special reader notation that uses the quote, hash, colon, and then Fred. It creates a symbol for me with the print name Fred, but it's a symbol that is not in any package, just like with make symbol. And I can use that in my macro. And actually the macro gets shorter now because I don't need the, if we go back for a moment and see, so I had this let that creates the gensims and remembers the values of the gensims. And obviously I could have chosen more sensible values. But this thing uses a special reader macro, hash one equals, and then hash colon BZZ. That creates a symbol whose print name is BZZ, but it's not in any package. It can never be referenced again, except using hash one within this particular call, within this particular set of parentheses. So it creates a symbol as if using make symbol, except it's not created during evaluation, it's created by the reader when it reads this code, and it remembers that it's seen it and throws that symbol now because it's not in a package. And the reader remembers that it's seen it by this hashtag on it and can reference it again later in the code. And if you can get your head around that, then you can see that this macro is much more concise because it doesn't have that let layer around it. So it actually becomes a nice way to write macros that have unique symbols that are guaranteed to not occur in any code that you can pass into the macro. And it also shows how powerful the reader is, because the reader can do lots of things that would otherwise happen at evaluation time. So what happens then if I want to create a symbol I know we're running late, but I'll wrap up shortly. What happens if I want to create a symbol where I am given a string and I want to have it in my package? Then I use the intern function. The intern function creates a symbol with the same name, the same print name, and it is in my package, so I can look it up by name. So for example, in my FizzBuzz code, if you remember back to that, we had the symbols Fizz and Buzz returned by the whatever request into that code. And if I wanted to do that by joining the symbols together, then I could actually convert the symbols into strings, concatenate the strings, and then convert the string back into a symbol, which is a little bit clunky, but it's entirely possible. This is my last slide for today, and we'll be wrapping up then. So symbols in Lisp have very few restrictions. One of the few restrictions you have is you can't have parentheses in them, or normally you can't have parentheses in them. Emacs does not map the case of a symbol. Common Lisp does. Every symbol is mapped to uppercase by the reader unless you tell it not to. So just a compatibility note, because Emacs will not change the case of a symbol when it tries to read something. So symbols are actually very powerful. You can even put sort of asterisks and slashes and stuff into symbols if you feel the need for that. This b squared minus 4ac divided by 2a is a single symbol, indivisible. There are no individual components inside. It is a single symbol used by Lisp. So I know this is a little bit technical, but I think if you go through this in details, you'll find that this is actually quite useful, because you can get Lisp where you need to create symbols. You either create them in your package or not in your package. If they're not in a package, you can never reference them again, except by tagging them or by remembering them in a variable or something. And it's actually quite useful for being able to construct things when you need unique names, or when you need to just construct symbols in your package so you can reference them again. And with that, I will stop here. Thank you.